Well, Jennifer, thank you very much for that introduction. I'm studying with suffering with my voice, so I hope that's going to hold out through this next 25 minutes. I've been thinking, too, about the process of curating, the way that we carefully select material and contextualize it in order to offer new narratives, new understandings in our subject areas. We do this whether we're organizing an exhibition or writing a catalogue. If we have a permanent collection, then that is where we must focus our research. I think that's going to shift as online collections undermine traditional boundaries, where on-site visitors have a vivid impression of the identity of a collection hanging together in its own building or suite of buildings. For our web visitors, the confines of ownership and the physical issues of display that we as curators must negotiate are immaterial. The experience of online journeys opens up new possibilities, a myriad of connections. It challenges the assumption that a narrative should be linear. As head of historic buildings and research at historic royal palaces, the Banqueting House in Whitehall is part of our collection. And my research explores issues of function and meaning surrounding its design by Inigo Jones in 1619. It has the reputation, particularly among architectural historians, of being the first Palladian building to be completed in England. And it provides a painted backdrop to a portrait by Paul Van Somer of James I. A slightly earlier portrait of his consort, Queen Anne of Denmark, also by Van Somer, includes a second Inigo Jones structure in the background. A luminous classical gateway marking the boundary between her palace of Oatlands in Surrey and the open parkland that was her hunting ground. There are other portraits of Inigo Jones's patrons with classical buildings in the background. The Earl and Countess of Arundel, for example, at their home on the Strand, with their sculpture and painting galleries running down towards the Thames, painted by Daniel Mytens around 1618. There's an obvious question about the status of classical architecture and its role in contributing to the visual identity of the early Stuart court. Were these painted buildings indicators of the cultural sophistication, the cosmopolitan tastes of their owners? They coincide with a period when the value of paintings and the function of galleries were changing as collecting began to take hold in Britain. But they're also invaluable to architectural historians as a documentary record of buildings that have subsequently been lost or altered, and of architectural aspirations. The gateway at Oatlands appears to be an accurate architectural record, but the Banqueting House, as Sir Oliver Miller has observed, records the general appearance of the new building. And when I put my finger up, it's because I'm quoting, it's not because I want something else, but is rather a garbled version of what was being built. Both paintings are in the Royal Collection, and Miller, as Deputy Surveyor of the Queen's Pictures, catalogued them in 1963. I'm going to look in detail today at the Oatlands portrait because it provides insights into another of historic royal palaces' buildings, Hampton Court Palace, where Anne of Denmark died and the painting now hangs, and because it rewards a more complex approach. Miller's rigorous scholarly catalogue provides the foundations for subsequent studies of the painting. He itemises the dimensions of the painting, the fact that it is signed and dated 1617, the subject is described, the Queen in hunting dress with her horse and black groom in scarlet livery with the Palace of Oatlands in the background. The owl in the tree above is associated with Minerva and wisdom, the breed of greyhounds identified as Italian. And the banner above the Queen's head, La mia grandezza dall'Celso, my greatness is from on high, is described as one of her favourite mottos. Miller notes the coincidence of the completion of Inigo Jones's alterations at Oatlands with the year of the painting, and references his corresponding design for the gateway in the RIBA drawings collection. The canvas is therefore a tribute, he concludes, to the Queen's love of building and patronage of Inigo Jones, as well as a display of her passion for the chase and a deliberate advertisement of the divine guidance with which she felt herself inspired. 50 years later, the Royal Collection Trust online catalogue is a testament to the enduring qualities of Miller's scholarship. It hardly deviates from that description. This model of concision is our stock in trade as curators. We can summarise a lifetime into a text panel of 100 words. It's what we're trained to do. Through his literature review and provenance details, Miller directs inquiries to the secondary and primary source material. But all too often, an original inventory in Sussex or a 17th century building account remains unexplored and effectively closed. The same extract is quoted and requoted again and again. For Anne of Denmark, it is a line from an unpublished inventory of Oatlands, dating and locating the arrival of the painting there by the 7th of October 1617, in ye gallery, next ye vineyard, Her Majesty's own picture, with her horse by her done at large. What I'd like to do now is to crack the catalogue like an egg and open up some of those documentary sources to suggest new ways of curating our collections. As a profession, we have a long tradition of contextualising paintings by putting them with other paintings, either in our permanent galleries or in exhibitions. But we also know from our research how vivid, how thrilling the archive material that relates to them can be. There are two inventories for Oatlands written exactly a year apart. The first, taken at Her Majesty's remove in October 1616, describes the contents of a garden stone gallery. A large picture of Diana and her maids viewing their quarry of red deer, conies and boar, etc. A better picture of a gardener with his son and daughter selling in Newmarket melons, cabbages and other herbs and fruit. Another picture of Noah's Ark, setting out him, his wife and children, with variety of creatures coming into the Ark. Another of like bigness of Jupiter and the gods feasting. Oatlands was a Tudor palace assigned to Queen Anne of Denmark in 1611. And there are two separate galleries, the gallery and the garden stone gallery, listed in the 1616 inventory. The contents of both will benefit further study. But as we look at the last page of that 1616 inventory with its paintings of Mammon, of Lucretia, of Venus bewailing her dead Adonis, I want you to keep Diana and her maids viewing their quarry and Jupiter and the gods feasting in your minds and to draw your attention to the last item in the inventory, a list of furniture. And this furniture had come to Oatlands from Somerset House, one of the Queen's other palaces, I quote, "against ye feasting of the ambassador." A later hand, which we can identify with 1618, has added Spanish before ambassador. This is no ordinary furniture. There were 24 high stools in total, covered with cloth of silver in various colours and fringed with silver. And they appear to be located in the Garden Stone Gallery at Oatlands in October 1616. I want to introduce you now to a small team who you will find in the National Archives in the declared accounts for the Stuart Court. And they were responsible for apparelling and making ready the palaces with tapestries and other pieces from the royal wardrobe in advance of royal visits. We can follow them from Whitehall Palace and the banqueting house there to Hampton Court, Greenwich Palace, Windsor Castle and the other Stuart strongholds. To some extent, we can trace the movements of Anne of Denmark and James I through their work. So here we have one gentleman usher, one yeoman usher, four yeoman hangers, two grooms of the chamber, two grooms of the wardrobe and one groom porter in September 1616, making ready Windsor for His Majesty, including St George's Chapel and the chapel in the house. They spent 2 days making ready a dinner house in the Great Park there and another two on a dinner house at Oakland. September and October are prime time for hunting, and we may conjecture that there is a connection between the dinner house at Oatland and the imported furniture in the 1616 inventory. Inigo Jones, as surveyor of the King's Works, was employed at Oatlands in 1616, and again I want to present you with an archive in its undigested state, as an object in its own right. We find what we're looking for as historians. We select and extract material from archives. But here, looking at Jones's outstanding account after the Queen's death in 1619 as an entity, we see his work at Oatlands as he presented it alongside two other projects from 1616. It's for Her Majesty's buildings at Greenwich and Oatlands and for charges of a mask at Denmark House in the year 1616. This last includes the design or scheme and the said Inigo Jones finding all the cloth, colours, gold, silver and all the works of the painters and gilders by agreement between the late Queen's Majesty and him. Architectural historians have focused on the task works for the great gate at Oatlands on the same page of this account. Edward Kinnisman, Mason, was paid for squaring, working and setting the great gate in Carn's stone, being 12 foot high and 7 foot broad between the jambs, having on the side Doric columns, rough rustic. What interests me here is the confluence of Jones's work across palaces, across distinct areas of design activity, and the creative interplay between his work as a designer and the Queen's direction. Paul Van Somer's portrait of Queen Anne of Denmark does record her love of building and her patronage of Inigo Jones, as Oliver Miller suggests. An engraving of a lost Elizabethan drawing shows that its background provides a remarkably accurate representation of Oatlands. So here we have the drawing from the west front of Oatlands, and here is Inigo Jones's gate. So I wonder, in fact, whether that was the primary objective of the portrait. Both James I and Queen Anne of Denmark were exceptionally keen hunters, and this is a portrait of the Queen at her hunting palace. The vantage point for the painting, from the parkland to the southeast of the palace, takes no account of Henry VIII's magnificent Tudor west front. Rather, it locates the experience of hunting with the Queen. Inigo Jones's white stone archway promises an alternative experience of entrance into the palace grounds, perhaps at the conclusion of a day's hunting. It opens up into the Queen's new walled garden, a south-facing vineyard that would fruit during the early autumn hunting season, and a long walk through the privy garden beyond. The location of Ye Gallery next the vineyard, as given in the 1617 inventory, suggests that the Queen's collection of paintings, including this new portrait, might potentially have contributed to the succession of carefully orchestrated impressions that ambassadorial visits were designed to deliver. A member of the Venetian embassy, Horatio Bussino, provides a vivid account of such a visit on the 30th of August 1618 and its emphasis upon the hunt. The Queen sent the Venetian ambassador a gift of two fat bucks flayed according to the custom of the country in advance of this visit. 2 days later, she sent, you can imagine the postman, 2 days later, she sent a very large stag, quite whole, with the hide and his fine horns. These impressive gifts were accompanied by her solicitations for the very long journey, a distance of 18 miles from London to Oatlands. The ambassador was met by the Queen's Lord Chamberlain, who kept him company while they awaited the arrival at the palace of the chief ladies of title, who had been invited for greater display, and that's the display of their costly dress and their jewels. When all was in readiness, His Excellency was led by the Lord Chamberlain into the presence chamber and was graciously received by Her Majesty, who gave him her hand. They remained some time standing during the first ceremonies, which were most stately and grave. Then the Queen seated herself on the dais, making His Excellency sit likewise. A circle of ladies and cavaliers stood respectfully at a distance, and the conversation, Bassino recalled, was chiefly about the hunt. They planned to kill 4 head in various fashions, to fly falcons and the like, and the Queen herself was to follow it without her court. In the event, incessant rain prevented this famous sport. There is no reference to the Inigo Jones gateway or the vineyard in Bassino's account. His description of the day, nevertheless, populates the inventory account of the previous year and articulates the ceremonial functions that the Queen's recent alterations to Oaklands would stage. The rich new hangings, carpets, and furniture listed in the 1617 inventory of Her Majesty's own stuff in Oaklands were not distributed evenly throughout the Tudor palace. They were concentrated in her more intimate spaces and in the two galleries, now named the North and South Galleries. Her bedchamber, her next withdrawing chamber, and her outer withdrawing chamber were furnished with new tapestries, embroidered silk and satin hangings, and velvet embroidered carpets. The inventory begins with textiles, reflecting their material value, but it provides other insights too. A cabinet and a book chamber were hung with devotional paintings that the Queen sent for to Hampton Court in the last months of her life. A picture of Our Saviour, Our Lady, Joseph and Mary. A picture of Our Saviour and Ye Woman of Samaria. A picture of Our Saviour's birth and ye shepherds coming to him. A picture of night work when ye soldiers put forcefully a reed into Our Saviour's hand. This inner sanctum would have resounded with codified visual messages for the avowedly Protestant queens more privileged, and in particular for her Catholic visitors. Van Zomer's bold and innovative portrait of Queen Anne was initially the first painting in the South Gallery, next to the vineyard. Its proximity there to portraits of Elizabeth I, of Henry IV of France, and of the Queen's brothers, including the Prince of Denmark, warrants further analysis. It's one of the earliest known portraits by Van Zomer after his arrival in London the previous year. The only other signed and dated portrait by him, known to have been painted in 1617, is a more conventional portrait of Shakespeare's patron and the Lord Chamberlain, William Herbert, 3rd Earl of Pembroke. Intriguingly, one of the discoveries in the Oaklands inventory is the Lord Chamberlain Pembroke's picture, which arrived in the North Gallery in 1617. It raises the possibility that Anne of Denmark may have commissioned her portrait with that of the Lord Chamberlain. And the contrast between those two images, I think, is very revealing. Diana and her maids, Jupiter and your gods feasting, and Venus bewailing the dead Adonis are also listed in the North Gallery, and both the North and South Galleries are lavishly furnished with plumed canopies, great chairs, stools, cushions, and carpets in the 1617 inventory. After her audience with the Venetian ambassador, the Queen withdrew to her own apartments from one end of the presence chamber, and he was led from the other end into dinner. This was prepared in a large and comely place for about 20 persons. The Countess of Arundel was seated at his side. He described her as the Queen's favourite, the chief lady of the court and kingdom. They talked of Venice, which she had visited with her husband and Inigo Jones some years earlier. She was resolutely Catholic. The other courtiers followed according to rank, a matter in which they never make a mistake, Bassino wrote. The trophies of previous hunts, perhaps inevitably, featured large on the menu. Venison, uncommon game such as we have never seen before, and exquisite fish prompted a favourable comparison with the most famous banquets in Italy. Bassino was at pains to describe the honour of being seated alone on a high elbow chair of crimson velvet, whereas all the other cavaliers and ladies were on stools without any support, though covered with silk. And this interest in the decorative arts as part of the experience, I think, is fascinating. The North Gallery was furnished with a suite of silver and carnation velvet. The ambassador was granted a second audience after the meal with Anne of Denmark, with whom he remained a long while in very pleasant discourse. The rain never let off, and as it was no longer possible to go out sporting and the evening was coming on, he was taken to his coach by the Lord Chamberlain and he travelled back to London, extremely well satisfied. Every moment of his time at Oatlands, aside from the weather, had been planned and stage managed. It's possible, piecing together our fragments of evidence, it's possible that Anne of Denmark commissioned Paul Van Somer to paint her portrait at Oatlands to hang in her new galleries there. It's possible that as galleries began to be associated with connoisseurship and collecting, the grouping together of biblical and mythological subjects or of portraits of current and former royal families and courtiers conveyed meanings that we can no longer understand. Earlier accounts of ambassadorial visits describe an hour in the handsome gallery at Whitehall, adorned with various paintings between a ceremonial banquet and the dancing that concluded the evening. The Oatlands inventories and the declared accounts suggest that the Garden Stone Gallery may have housed an ambassadorial dinner in 1616. It's also possible that it was simply used as safe storage for costly furniture. If the weather had been fair on the 30th of August 1618, Pacino's vividly documented visit might have included an account of the greatly anticipated hunt, and he might have noticed Jones's Venetian-style gateway and the Queen's new walled vineyard. He could not have seen the Van Somer portrait because it was removed to Prince Charles's palace at St. James's in March 1618, within months of its initial installation. Paintings shift in significance, as we curators know, depending upon their location and the company they keep. That is why exhibitions continue to fascinate. Online, we can allow them this movement. We can explore their complex relationships with buildings and gardens, with other paintings and the decorative arts that, in their own time, held far greater intrinsic value. We can explore the coincidence of their creation with the cultural, social, and political events of the day. You might listen in the future to Bassino's letter, I'm sure it would sound wonderful in Italian, or read the palace inventory in full. You might compare Anne of Denmark's portrait with that of her Spanish counterpart, Margaret of Austria. This portrait on the left was a gift to James I 12 years earlier, after the signing of the Anglo-Spanish peace agreement. Or with this later portrait of Margaret of Austria, painted by Velazquez, again with an elaborate garden in the background. And you might wonder about the purpose of these paintings. The very nature of the web and its potential to create clusters and to facilitate global connections is already changing the way that we research. For my purposes, the Oatlands portrait and the visual and documentary evidence surrounding it between 1616 and 1618 provide a moment in court history which illuminates Hampton Court, another hunting palace for the Stuarts, and a building in our own collection. In testing our assumptions about the role of portraiture and architecture to stage the Stuart Court, it may also provide a methodology for new understandings of the banqueting house at Whitehall. Again, there's an Inigo Jones building, and again, it forms the background to a portrait of the monarch by Paul Van Somer. But in this instance, it is the mask rather than the hunt that is the main event. And that is another story, another related cluster. Thank you.